Salesforce is a CRM, and CRM says software, like any other software, will have data to store, right? So where do we store data in Salesforce? Just like in Excel sheet, right? Excel, if you open any sheet or open Excel, it will open a sheet. It will have rows and columns, right? So this will be called a table, wherein you can put your details. This will be data. Similarly, in Salesforce, these tables, same tables are there. And since these tables are called objects. So table is equal to objects in Salesforce. Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, no, sir.
Now, objects can be of objects or tables in Salesforce. Can be of two types, standard and custom. What is standard object? Standard object means these objects are already given by Salesforce, preloaded or pre-created, existing. So these objects or these tables are already given by Salesforce. You cannot delete these tables. Okay, these tables are already there, and these tables will always be there. You cannot delete these tables. Clear? Custom tables are tables which you create. These tables or objects are not there when you start Salesforce. Right, just like you launch a Trailhead, from Trailhead you launch a new playground for yourself in Salesforce. Custom objects will not be there. Salesforce will only give you standard objects. Custom objects is something which you have to create. When you create it, it is called a custom object. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, standard object. Custom object. Standard object can be created. No, right?
No, standard objects are already by default there.
By default there. You cannot create a standard object. Whenever you create a new object, it is a custom object. Yes. Clear?
Yeah.
Can you edit or modify a standard object? No. Yes. How? Yes. We'll go.
Yes.
Can you modify a custom object? Yes, you can.
Yes.
Can you modify, can you delete a standard object?
No.
You cannot.
No, sir.
Can you delete a custom object?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
sir.
Again, standard object, custom objects. Standard object and custom. Every table will have what? If you think about a table here, every table will have a header row. Why that header row is needed? So if you open Excel sheet and you start filling like this, Shobhanjit@gmail.com. Bosch, next to Animesh, a.ban@something energy. If you start filling in Excel sheet like this, these are data. But do you know what data is this? This data or what is this? What is this? What is this? What is this? You do not.
Those are metadata.
Metadata, yeah.
That's why you have to put a header row on the top, and you have to say this is the first name. This is the second name. This is the last name. Yeah, something of that sort.
Yes.
So that is called a description of data. So, to follow the session. Okay, well, chat in the session. Okay, session. So, Ashish.
Yeah.
আজ চারটে নাগাদ ঢোকো সেশনটা, ঠিক আছে? Okay, so what happens is that you need a header row to describe
one problem.
Yeah,
actually, I couldn't understand the header portion. Once more, can you?
Yes, thanks for like stopping me and asking these questions. It is very important that you stop me if you are not clear. Yeah, it is very, very important and crucial for you to. Be very clear before we move ahead. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
So this is Excel sheet, right?
Yeah.
So here, if I start putting some values like this, let me enlarge it.
Yeah, I can see.
You can see, right?
Okay. Yeah, it's okay.
Oh, so if I store these values in a table, right? This is a table, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So if I do this, do I know what value? These are data, right? Everything is data.
Yeah, yeah.
But do I know if something like this is pasted there? Will I understand what is this data about?
No.
So I have to put a column on the top in order to describe this data, right? I have to say this is the first name. This is the last name.
Okay. Well, this person is not understanding.
Now, this is email. This is phone number. And this is maybe additional information.
Yeah. Okay. Now it's clear, sir.
Yeah. So this header row is very crucial for describing the data, right?
Yes.
That. So in Salesforce also, we have a table like this, and any table you create like this. So let me make a table like this and rename this table called employee.
Yeah.
This is your table, new table. There can be standard tables. We will discuss those later. So I have created first name, last name, email, phone, and additional. So a table will have columns and will have column rows, column headers. Exactly. These column headers in Salesforce is called fields. Okay. An individual row wherein you are putting data, it is called records. This is record. This is a record. And every here is a field one. Field two. Yeah.
Okay.
So all this, it is a structure of a table, right? If we delete this table and delete this data out, then we have a structure of a table wherein you can fill up data, right? If I give this to somebody, he can fill up data, right?
Yeah.
What to fill what? So this kind of a table structure is called the field and this table put together is called metadata. Metadata means description of data.
Okay.
And individual data which I am filling is called data, right? Every record all put together is data. So its structure of a table is called metadata. And individual data
is called data.
Getting filled up is called
data,
right? So here, your job as a system administrator or your role would be to change the software. That means you will be creating a new table or object. You will be adding new columns. You will be deleting any existing columns. Your job is to work on the structure. You are not filling this data. Who is filling this data? A business user is filling this data. He is using software, a CRM, to work on his business. But you are a technical user. Technical user is a system administrator. And they work only on metadata. So business user will work on data. Technical user will work on metadata. Clear? So your job is a technical user. You will be working on metadata only. Data also you will work sometimes, but that is in a very rare situation where a business user is not able to work. Yeah, but you will not basically create data or delete data or modify data. You will create containers for other people to fill up. Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go back to our table. In any business, there is a seller and there is a buyer. Is it?
Yes, sir.
So, who will purchase Salesforce? The seller or the buyer?
Seller.
Both of them could purchase. The seller must purchase, but if the buyer is also a seller for somebody else, then he can also purchase.
Possible. But in this context of one business,
then the seller must purchase because yes. He have to target customers and he have to fulfill right. Their demand. Yep.
So this guy is owning Salesforce or he has purchased Salesforce, right? Seller is basically, we are talking about B2B business here mainly. There are two kinds of business. One is B2B and is B2C. What is B2B? Business to business. What is business to business? One company is selling to another company.
Another company.
And business to customer is one company selling to another
individual. Customer. Individual customer.
Individual customer.
Okay. So here mainly we will talk about B2B business because Salesforce is mostly utilized in B2B scenario. B2C scenario is a different business model. We'll talk about that also. Salesforce can be used in that scenario also. But let's talk about B2B most of the time. Yeah. In our whole process, we'll first complete B2B business model and we'll see the nuances which is there in the B2C sales process later. So let's talk about a sales again, the situation. So what we are saying that the seller is basically owning Salesforce. Sellers have employees, right?
Yes, sir.
Sellers will have CEO of that company. Buyer will also have a CEO. That is probably the owner. And it will also have other employees. The lobby also have other employees, right? So the seller, when they have a sales force, it's called an org or organization. I will show that. Yeah, it's org. There is no table to store an org because it's only one information to share. So it's called an org. Seller will purchase a Salesforce org. So seller is called an org. If this org will have a unique identifier, org number will be there, org ID will be there. That is unique. So if there is another seller which is purchasing Salesforce, that will have a separate org ID. Clear? It's like different Gmail accounts. If you have Gmail, you log in to gmail.com. I also log in to gmail.com. When you log in, do you come to my mailbox or I can go to your mailbox? Is it possible?
No. No, sir.
Not possible, right? So because it is that ID is mapped to your mailbox and my ID is mapped to my mailbox. Similarly, all the users of this org here is not a one user, right? There will be multiple users working on the software. So all the employees of the seller org, if they are users of Salesforce, all will be logging into the same org ID. Clear? And they can share data between each other. We'll see all details. What is the buyer? Buyer is logging into Salesforce?
Yes.
Buyer is not logging into Salesforce. Okay? In our sales process. There can be situations when they are logging in. We'll talk about that later. For now, let's assume buyer is not logging into Salesforce. So seller employees will be logging and using Salesforce, right? So they have the users. So all employees may or may not be users. Maybe a set of users only who are dealing with customers. They will be only the users of Salesforce, right? Because this is a CRM. There can be backend systems also. Maybe they are working on billing systems and so on. That is not CRM. In that case, those employees need not be users, right? So user is a subset of employee. All users are employees, but not all employees are users. Is it clear? Now let's see this model here. How are we storing the buyer information in Salesforce then? Now buyer is the seller's customer, right?
Yes.
So buyer is of two types. One is the company information you have to store, plus the employee's information you have to store, or the CEO's information you have to store. These are individuals, right? So you have to store the company information and you have to store the individuals who are working in that company or who are basically storing them. So Salesforce gives two objects to us by default. That means standard objects to store our customers' information. One object is called account, to store company information. Another object is called contact. These are two tables which Salesforce offers us to store individuals. So companies are stored in account table, individuals, customers, individuals are stored as contacts. Clear? Any problem? Guys,
no sir. So one question, contact can be always under an account or contact can be without an account also, right?
Contact can be without an account, but that is called a private account contact, but usually that is of no use.
Okay.
You can store, of course, in your phone, what is that contact doing there? Is he related to any business? Is he related or is he basically your customer? If it is a customer, definitely in a B2B business, he will be associated to a company, right?
Okay, all right. So that one contact can be, that one contact can be an account itself. Like if it's one individual who is acting as an account, right?
We will talk about B2C business later and we'll see the nuances there. Let's finish the B2B part first.
Okay.
Because in B2C business, your customer is the individual. There is no company involved, right? So how will that be different? So we'll come to that later. But let's finish this part first. So I have an account and I have now a concept called contact. The account is basically storing the company information or company. And this is storing the employee information of that company or individuals, right? What is the relationship between a company and individuals? Is it 1:1, 1:many, or 1:many?
1:many.
Why 1:many?
Because one account can have multiple contacts.
Why?
Account is used to store company information.
Right.
For the seller, of the seller, and
no, account is storing the company information of the buyer. seller is the person who is selling the selling products, and seller is owning the sales, owning Salesforce, and he's called org. A seller is an org. Seller is org. Buyer is account. Clear? Very important to understand. Buyer is the customer. If you are selling shoes, you are the seller. You have Salesforce. If you are selling shoes to somebody else, he's a buyer. You will store his information in your software. Otherwise, what is the point of a CRM?
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? What is the point of storing your information in the software? You are doing business with other people, right? You will store your customer's information in that software. You will not store your information in the software, right?
That means actually if we are storing in account that customer companies all details there.
Yes, account is the company information, contact is all the people who are working in this company. So it is one to many, because in this company there can be many people working, right?
Yes.
So that is why it is one to many, and all these both together is becomes your customer.
Yes.
So account and contact relationship is one to many. There can be many contacts. That means there can be many employees of a company to whom I am trying to sell. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fantastic. So we have talked about two standard objects. One is account and one is contact. What are we selling? When we are talking we, now at this point, I am talking as a seller, okay? So when we are saying we are selling, we are thinking ourselves as seller, okay? So let's see from the point of view from the seller, because you are an administrator of a selling org, right? You will become an administrator of a selling org. That means you are an employee of the seller, right? So you are selling the business, right? There can be a different IT business. We'll talk about that later. But let's see. Let's think ourselves as sellers. So we are selling what?
Products,
absolutely. So product is another table Salesforce gives by default. Simple. Another table is there. Standard table, of course, right? Standard object. It will have product name, it will have product code. There are many functions, right? So I am selling products. So I have a list of products. Now, I will take a break of 1 minute and I will give you a question to think over, and I will come back and ask you and give you replies. If you are Burger King, you are selling what products? You are selling burgers, right? Now, if you're selling burgers, does your company have only one menu card, or can it have multiple menu cards? I will take that answer. If you say one, you will give me the reason. And if you say multiple, you will have to give me a reason. I will be back. Give me just 1 minute. Yes, guys, I'm back.
Sir, I have one thing to ask.
Yes.
Like, why are we talking about multiple menus with multiple foods on it? Are we talking about a particular menu?
You give me the scenario. Burger King, can you have multiple menu cards?
Yes, sir, we can have multiple menu cards, like a festive menu card or something, depending on a particular festival or an event. So we have multiple menu cards with multiple food options. Yes, we can.
Multiple food options, okay. My question was for a single product.
Yeah.
Can I have multiple menu cards?
Yes.
For a single particular product?
Yes.
Yes. So it can be seasonal, it can be promotional.
Mm-hmm.
And it can be a regular menu card.
Correct. Can I have region specific prices? Yes, multiple prices for the same product?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I was about to say that, because in different places of the world, it can have different prices.
So maybe in India, I have 100 rupees.
Yes, sir.
And in USA, maybe I have $20.
Yes, sir.
Maybe in UK, I have 10 pounds. So I will need multiple menu cards for the same product, right? Why? Because the prices might vary.
Yes, sir.
Also, it can be promotional. Like in India itself,
right.
I'm selling a veg burger, but maybe on Thursday, it's a mega Thursday. So I'm selling one free with two.
Right.
So
absolutely. So I have product at one side, I have menu at another side. So what is the relationship between the product and menu? Is it one-to-one, one-to-many, or many-to-many?
For a particular product, it's one-to-many.
Now let's talk about the whole relationship.
It can be many-to-many.
Why?
Can have multiple products. It can be both one to many or many to many, because it can have multiple products and many menus, and it also can be like one product and many menus.
So if there is a possibility of multiplicity, then we don't tell it one to many. Okay, we'll always consider that as n, because n also means one. Okay.
Okay.
So let's revise our answer once again. So tell me, what is the relationship between two tables, product and menu?
Many to many.
If there are two products, product one and product two, menu card one and menu card two.
Because when a company is using Salesforce, he is not actually selling only one of his products. He's selling all of them. So it's basically many to many.
No, that is not the reason. If you have multiple products, that does not make it a many to many relationship. Relationship is the, in the context of another table.
Okay.
Multiple products does not make it by default many relationship. In account table, you can store multiple accounts, but account to contact relationship is one to many, right?
Yes.
Wait, your answer is not right. Clear?
Yes.
In account table, you can store multiple accounts. That does not mean you will have a many to many relationship between account and contact. Because relationship between is based on the context. One account will have multiple contacts. One contact will not have multiple accounts. That is why it is not many to many.
Okay.
When you have many to many relationship, means it is one to many from this side and one to many from this side, then it becomes a many to many relationship.
You mean to say that in one menu, having variety of n number of products is not many products typically?
If this is the menu card one, okay?
Yeah.
It has product one and it has product two. What kind of relationship is this?
One to many.
One to many. Absolutely. So which side is one?
Menu is one.
And this side is many, right? Many. Yes. Similarly, this is also same, right? This menu card will have this product and this product.
Yeah.
So one to many.
So now look
from the other side. This product can be part of this menu card and this menu card. So it is one too many. Again, one becomes one too many, right? So yes. It is both one too many from both sides. When it becomes one too many from both sides, it becomes a many to many relationship. Clear? Any confusion?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In account and contact, one to many relationship from contact to account was not there. That is why it never became a many to many relationship.
Yeah.
Because one contact will not have multiple accounts. Clear? Okay. So now in Salesforce, you cannot directly have a direct relationship between two tables which having one to many to many relationship. You have to create another table. That table needs to have a one to many relationship from both sides. Then only a many to many relationship between these two objects will be implemented. How, what does that mean? Let's see that. So this object is called mapping table or mapping object. Okay. So let's take a mapping object example. So there are two products, product one, product two, menus, menu card one, menu card two. How do this mapping object will work? I will create product one, menu card one, product one, menu card two, product two, menu card one, product two, menu card two. Four entries in the table will make sure that my many to many relationship is taken care of. Clear? How? Product one is now related to one and two. Product two is now related to one and two. Menu card is now related to product one and product two. Menu card two is now related to product one and product two. Clear? This is a mapping object.
Yes,
now, since these two are standard objects, Salesforce has also given the standard object mapping object. What is the name of these tables? Let's talk about this. The product table is just called product. The menu card table in Salesforce is called price book. And this table, which is the mapping object, is called price book entry. Clear? Let's give some examples here. I am Reebok. What products I am selling? I am selling shoe and cap. Whom I am selling this? I am selling to TCS. Sorry, not TCS. I don't care. I will be selling it. So there can be shoe and caps, and I have multiple menu card. What? Indian menu card or Indian, and another is US menu card. Two menu card I have. So what will my junction object my mapping object have? Entries minimum. My shoe, which menu card? Shoe, USA, cap, India, and cap, USA. Right? So I know this shoe needs to be added to India menu card. The shoe needs to be added to US menu card. Cap needs to be added to India menu card. Cap needs to be added to US menu card. Where will I store the price? Price is very important, right? In a menu card, you will. What is the? It is mainly used for. Menu card is used mainly to see what are the your list of products you are selling and what is the price for that, right?
Yes, sir.
Where will I store my price? In this table, or this table?
In the mapping object.
Why?
Because shoe has a different price for India and USA, and cap has a different price for India and USA.
Great reply. Yes, absolutely. So here I will say it is 100 rupees. Here I will say $20. Even I will say 200 rupees. Here I will say $40. That makes sense, right?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So we have now got a relationship. It is one to many and one to many. And this becomes a virtual many to many relationship. This is called price book entry. This is called price book. We'll see all details in Salesforce. So don't worry about it. Is those concepts clearing session? Same product. Will be sold to different customers. Right? Before going to product and customers, let's discuss the account one second. So I have account. I have multiple people working in that account. How many orders? There is another table called order or a deal, right? If you go to Flipkart, you choose your products and then place an order, right?
Yes.
That's a deal, right? Total deal. That is a, so this order is another object. So say a customer will place an order, right? With multiple products. It's never going to purchase only a single product, may or may not. So basically I'm trying to sell. So I am, there is an order in place. So what is the relationship between an account and order? One to many? Many to many?
One to many.
One to many, sir.
Many to many.
Hmm?
Many to many.
Many to many, why?
Because the order, it can be into of different accounts also.
No, it cannot.
Okay, correct. Yeah, it cannot, because that will be a glitch. So right. it's a
order has to be shipped.
It can be one to many.
Yes, it is one. So this in Salesforce, the order object is called opportunity, or deal object is called opportunity. Okay. Account, contact, opportunity. So both opportunity and contact are one to many relationship with account, right? So when we have a one to many relationship, this side, the one side is called parent and the many side is called child. Yeah, because one parent might have multiple children. Yeah, but one child might have multiple parent, maybe possible. We'll look into that later. We just saw the mapping object, right? Mapping object is a child with multiple parents. Isn't it?
Yes.
So let's look at the product once again. And now let's have a relationship with the opportunity object. The opportunity is the deal or the order, right? So now the product is there. So what is the relationship between product and an opportunity?
One to many, sir.
Which side one or which side many?
Product side one and opportunity side is many.
So one product can be sold in multiple orders. Customer.
Yes, sir.
Not customer. Customer is not there in this relationship.
Yes, sir. Multiple orders can be placed for one particular product.
Multiple orders can be placed for one particular product. And you are saying that one order cannot have multiple products.
Actually, many to many.
Absolutely. Why?
Shoot. Because one product can be into multiple opportunities or orders, yes. And multiple opportunities can be for only one category of product.
Yeah. So let's see that shoe and cap are my two products, right? I have two orders, one for January and one for February. Right? So let's see my mapping object. Again, I said, if there is a man-to-man relationship, you cannot do that. directly, you have to have a mapping of it. So what needs to be done? Shoe, January, shoe, February.
Cab January, cab February.
Cab January, yeah, February. That means shoe has been ordered for January, shoe has been ordered for February, cab has been ordered for January, cab has been ordered for February. What is the critical information here missing? One critical information while you place an order in Flipkart. Think about it. Not your information. Any critical information needed here?
Price. Yeah.
Price is there in the menu card.
Okay. Yeah, understand.
Quantity,
absolutely. So how much? How much am I ordering? So 100, 200, 300, 400. Why here and why not here? And why not here?
Because each quantity would be for quantity specific for order only.
Order and product.
Yeah, order and product.
Right. That is why quantity is in the mapping table. So you remember in the price book, the price was there in the mapping table. And for this opportunity and deal, the quantity is in the mapping table. Very critical, right? Yes, understand this. So here I have two parents, parent one and parent two. And this is a child with two parents.
Yeah.
What is this mapping object called? Again, opportunity and product both are standard objects. This mapping object is also given by Salesforce. It is named after adding the names of the parents. It's called opportunity product. Yeah? Clear? So how many standard objects did we discuss till now? Account? Contact?
Product?
Yes. Product?
Opportunity.
And?
Opportunity.
Price book. Opportunity I already wrote. Price book, right? In the mapping
price entry.
Price book entry.
Price book, yes.
And then opportunity product.
Opportunity product.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 already objects, right? We have discussed. These are all standard objects given by Salesforce. Yeah. Now, another standard object is very crucial before we move into our discussion. All the people who are logging in, they are individuals, right? We talked about buyer side and seller side. In seller side, there can be different kinds of users. The business users, technical users, CEO, or other people, other users. Buyer side, everybody's account, contact. These users in the seller side, everybody, whoever needs an access to Salesforce, these are all individuals, right? These individuals' information is stored in a table called
users.
User will also have a first name, last name, and so on. All the details of an individual. Similarly, in the contact will also have a first name, last name, and all that, right? Let's look at the business from beginning. When a salesman rises in the day and starts his day, where from he will he get his customers?
From leads?
From leads, like, correct. So who will give him the leads?
The salesperson himself gets the customers. Contact. Okay, the marketing team will give him the leads.
Correct. Marketing team. Maybe he will reach out through campaigns.
Yeah. All different sources. Inquiries through websites.
Yeah.
through sourcing also, different types of sourcing.
Yeah. So what are leads and how different is lead with customers? What is lead and what is customer? What is the difference?
Lead is basically the generic inquiry which has come. So this goes through all the sales pipeline, and after getting the order confirmation, so it becomes the customer. So lead is in the pursuit state.
In Salesforce world, lead is any person. Who may or may not have interest in your product. A interested lead is becoming your customer. Yes. So there is a system called lead conversion in Salesforce. When you convert a lead, it becomes a customer. When it becomes a customer, where do we insert values?
In account and contact.
Absolutely. Account and contact. So one lead record in Salesforce will create a account and contact after lead conversion. Let me give you an example. I sell prawns, right? I will go to the sea and I will throw the net and I will capture fish. I will have all kinds of fish, right? But I will throw away all the fish. I will only keep the prawn. So all the fish which I have captured is lead. From there, the things which I am interested is prawns. So prawns is the customer. So all customers will start as leads, but not all leads will get converted to customers. Clear? A lead is a prospect. He may or may not be interested in purchasing. You are knocking him, that's it. Yes. So what is the point if that man has not even, there is no surety that he's done a purchase? Is there a need to store lead in Salesforce? What is the point of storing a lead in Salesforce? I will talk to him, then understand if he's interested or not. If he's interested, then I will store his information in Salesforce. A person may not be interested. Why should I store his information in Salesforce? What is the point?
Maybe for future opportunity, we can knock him again in future.
Absolutely. One reason might be a future opportunity. And what else? Anything else? If you talk to any salesman, and you ask him, what is your conversion ratio? He will tell you. If he goes to 100 people, 10 people buy the product. That means a 10% conversion rate. That means these 100 people are his leads. And only 10 people out of these leads become his customers. But the man is spending his whole day going after these 100 people, right? And this man who is working very hard for 100 people has to show what is he working on. He cannot say that I have got 10 customers only. What is the rest of the item? Where was he working on? Which leads where he is working on? That is very crucial for company to do, understand where the salesmen are spending time, how to optimize that, how to understand how to like not go after bad leads, analyze those data. That is the reason why lead information in Salesforce is absolutely critical. To give visibility on where the salesperson is working, do analysis to optimize so that I have better lead conversion. And third and foremost is future opportunities. Maybe he's not interested at this point. Maybe later. I get an option of knocking him once again if his information is stored in my system. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So how many standard objects did we talk now till now? Lead, account, contact. Again, lead is a standard object given by Salesforce. Account, contact, opportunity, opportunity product, price book, entry, and users. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All these objects are related to sales process. Right? We are not covering service process now. We'll discuss that later. Let's first understand the sales process. So sales process starts from lead, gets converted to account and contact, then to then a deal comes in, wherein opportunity product and opportunity product is used. Before that, you have to set the price book and price book entry. And of course, these are the login users who are using the application. These are all tables. These are all tables that is stored in Salesforce. Let's see all these tables. Guys, are you getting bored or getting interested? Let me know.
We're getting interested.
Good, good. Because sales process, understanding the sales process and service process is very critical for understanding CRM. Before even understanding CRM, you need to understand what is that CRM used for, right? That is very important. So let's see. If you are on the trailhead, you go to the hands-on orgs, you can create a new playground. These are practice Salesforce orgs, wherein you can do your practice and you can do your trailheads, everything, hands-on, everything. If you do a launch, it will also create it. That is fine. But I will start from scratch for you guys. That is why I'm showing it all. If you get screwed up, play around, create new orgs. These are all free. See how many orgs I have created? So keep on creating orgs if you're stuck somewhere or you're facing any challenges, problems. Yeah, no problem. If you're not using that org, it will be later deleted by Salesforce like this.
Org is a playground. It's same as a playground.
Org. Playground is basically a dummy org for you.
Okay, okay. And I can create as many as playgrounds.
As many as possible, yes. But why will you create as many as playgrounds?
Sometimes I have seen that, later that maybe somewhere, even if I've done the challenge, it's not coming. But when I do a create a new org and I do the same thing, yes. So I get the results.
Possible, possible. Sometimes it conflicts with the metadata of that previous org. Just like, so when I am creating a new org, what I am creating? I am creating an instance of Salesforce. That means I just like creating a Gmail account, right? I'm creating a new instance of Salesforce. That means a seller account. I'm creating a seller instance. And in that seller instance, you are one of the users. I will show you that. And you will be created as a system administrator. Yeah. You can create one more user only in these playgrounds. In actual paid Salesforce instances, you can create as much as users you want. So my org is now created. I will launch my org. If I launch from this, you don't need to do a login and user ID and password. From Trailhead, the user ID password is skipped if you launch it from here. Otherwise, you have to go for a user ID password. I will show you that also. So this is how Salesforce looks like if you launch it. Yeah. And this playground starter, this basically, you can install packages here, get your login credentials. You can reset your password here if you want. You do not know what is the login and user ID, yes? Because you're launching it from here. But here you will see what is the login. This is the login. And you can reset your password. It will come to you as a mail. And you can reset the password. Then you will have the user ID as password. Clear? Right now, there is no need for user ID password. You will always launch it from Trailhead. You don't have to remember anything. I will suggest to use that. This thing is called App Launcher. Just like in your mobile phone, there are multiple apps. Similarly, in Salesforce instance, there can be multiple apps. Some standard apps, which is already getting given by Salesforce. Right now, I created the login, right? So it is a standard app, Salesforce instance. So these apps come in handy by default. Apart from that, you can create your own app or you can modify these existing apps also. No problem. So we'll talk about sales app here because that is what we are discussing. You discussed all the objects, right? Standard objects. What is account? We discussed this, right? Is here. Contacts is there. Opportunities is there, right? All these leads is there. So all these objects we talked about, right? How do you see this in a table view? This is exactly. It's a recent view. If you change to all accounts, there is some default data already given by Salesforce. Yeah, for you to practice. That is it. It's some dummy data. Yeah, you can see some of the fields mentioned here. You can add your own fields. If you go there, select fields to display. You can take out some fields. Maybe this is bogus. Save it. So this becomes a billing city. Yeah. So this is a tabular structure, right? The complete table format. There can be many, many fields, but you don't need to see it everything. Same in account also, it's also a table. Here you also do all accounts and you'll see all the accounts. You can change which column to display and which column to not display. According to you, no problem. We'll talk about four objects. Account, contacts, leads. Leads also has similar view. All default leads are given. Opportunities also have a similar view. Yeah, four tabs, main tab.
I have a question.
Yeah.
That this is in particular Trailhead, you have entered so many records. And so there was one option that we can connect the orgs. So yes. If we have created a new trailhead and we connect both the orgs, so will all this data go into the new trailhead?
No. Data of an one org will always remain in that org. Data, if you want to upload data, you have to do an export from this org and you have to upload it into another org.
Okay. So what does it mean by connecting orgs then?
Connecting orgs means if you have a developer instance, that you can connect here.
Okay.
If you have a developer instance is also free. Previously, there was a concept of developer instance that you can also create. That is also a free org.
Okay.
If you have developer instance, you can connect that here. So that becomes your playground automatically instead of creating a new playground. So when you connect, then you can launch it from here. That is the benefit. Or use it for your practice also, hands-on practice. And use it for this trailheads for your hands-on exercises.
Okay, got it.
So these are default data which is already given by Salesforce for your practice. That is it. So let's create some new data. So what I said, how will the salesman work? So whatever view you are seeing right now is how a business user will use the application. Your job is not here. You as a system admin will work in this setup. This is your office. Here you change the application. Just like settings in mobile phone, right?
Yeah.
Settings and you change. So setup is your setting section, which wherein you change things. This the main app is used for using Salesforce and business users will be creating data and do, but changing on the application is done through setup. You are the person, you will be doing the setup. How to see that? Let's first see the users. If you search by user, you will see that your name will figure out here. It is automatically created by Salesforce. And you are showing as a profile means user type. This profile is system administrator. Yeah. You can create one more user only if you want on this work. Okay. So this is the user table wherein we are storing user information. If you click on this, you will see a lot of information of user can be stored. Salesforce way of using it is always some details will be there. There is a default detail section. There will be related lists. That means These are called related lists. What are related lists? We'll get to that later. But let's open setup on. There is an object manager tab in setup, wherein all the objects are there. Right now, I just created the org. You see, there is no custom object. Are you seeing any custom object? No custom object, right?
No.
Because Salesforce will not create custom objects for you, right? If you create new objects, then only custom objects is created. Before that, whatever default objects are there, these are all standard objects. Here you see account is there. And there are many, many objects. We are not discussing those. We are only discussing these 9 objects. And that is what we will stick to, because those are the key objects on which the work will be happening. If you go here and you can create custom object. One thing to remember that in standard object, if you go to any object, you will have fields and relationships. In that, you can see all the fields of that object. These are like Excel columns. We talked about columns, right?
Yes, sir.
Similar. These are the columns of the table. And you can create new columns if you want. These are all the options. Play around. We'll discuss this in detail in corresponding classes. What are these values, when to use these, and so on. We'll discuss.
Yes, sir. I have seen by doing the admin beginner and so on, the pick list type of object and like that.
So yeah, play around. But we'll discuss when to use what and so on. But yes, right, sir. Now, do whatever you want to do. Yeah, play around. So in account, you can create new fields using this new button. When you create new fields, it automatically needs to be added. That field needs to be added on the screen. Salesforce also gives screens of every table automatically. Those screens are called layouts.
Page.
In account, we have 4 screens, 4 type of screens. Why you have created 4 screens for the same table? If you see, it is like
marketing. Different views.
Yeah, different views. For why? Different type of people. Maybe I, as a marketing user, will use some fields. I don't need the sales and support fields. The sales and support might be working on some other sets of fields. They do not need the marketing fields, right? So I will not like make a huge screen with all the fields together, right? I will bifurcate that. And based on which kind of user is using, I will give a tight screen to him, right? So that he can be more productive. You may or may not have multiple layouts. Not all objects will have. Don't worry about it. And you can create new layouts also if you want. If you're not happy with all this 4, you can create new layouts. And if you go to page layout assignment, this is where you can see which screen is assigned to whom.
This is basically the UI that we are kind of doing.
I will show you where this UI is used. So this is basically, you'll see this layout, like which type of user is using what. It has been given here. You can change and go at edit assignment and you can change it. So where is this layout used? So let's see a whole process of Salesforce. We went to leads, right? I will start my day. I am a salesman. I will go a new, right? This is my screen. This is a layout. Clear, Priyanka?
Yes.
So I am trying to convert Priyanka Roy. Which company are you working with now?
R Labs.
So let's see. There are only last name and the company name is the mandatory field here. Nothing else. And the other mandatory field is auto field. So you don't have to worry about it. You can change the value, of course, but I will keep it not contact. I will save it.
Uh-huh. I don't understand.
So I have now created a lead. Priyanka Roy may or may not be interested in my products. What will I do? I will first call her. I will log a call. Contacted her and she has shown interest, need to follow up week. What I am doing here, I am logging a call. That means I am doing some activity here. So this is not a customer yet. But I am showing my boss that I am working today. I am spending time with a lead. I am trying to convert her. I am doing work. I am justifying my salary, isn't it? So these are activities which can happen on a on object. These activities can happen on any record. So lead record, Priyanka Roy is a lead record now. Okay. What we said, every row of a column, every row of a table is a record. So this is the detail of Priyanka Roy. This is exactly what I filled up, right? When I created it. And exactly this I can change directly here. I can go ahead, modify here. Or I can go to edit and it can open up. This is again page layout. The same page layout, which opened in new screen click and edit screen click. And it is read mode. Everything is the same layout. Okay. Layout is used here in details tab. Details tab basically is the layout. And in new and edit button click, whatever opens up is the same screen. So this screen is a collection of fields that will capture data, or you can modify data through that. These things are automatically created by Salesforce. And I will show you when we create a custom field. I can change the status here, or I can directly go and mark it as converted. When I do a conversion, you see, Salesforce is asking me the Marl Labs, the company information, Salesforce wants to automatically create an account with that. They want to create a contact with the lead information. All the fields of leads will go into contact. And they also are optionally asking me, I can choose not to create the opportunity, but they are asking me, can I create an opportunity? I said, yes, June order. I convert. When I do a convert, three records gets created in three tables. That means three objects. You see, one shot. You can individually go to each of the table and you can create it also. You can go to account. You can create a new account from here or here. Same thing. You can go and create account here. You can create Marlabs 2 from here also. And you go to account, you see two accounts. So I can create an account from here also. I need not use the lead conversion technique. So maybe it is an existing customer for me already. And I am only changing my CRM. At that point, you don't need lead. You will directly create your customer, right? For each, this model I've already got created a contact, right? You see under this account, there is a related list. This is a related tab. Under that, there are many related lists. And two related list has got created. These are child items are all related list. What was the child object? You remember that again, account has two child, one to many relationship with contact and opportunities. Both are child for account. So both will become related list here. All the childs will become related list. Clear? Making sense, guys? And account has details. You can go ahead and change account details. You can do activities in here also. You can add activities, events, logger call, everything. Yeah. Or you can add a new contacts also. Like Priyanka Roy was the person with whom I contacted. Then she's told that I, for doing this sale, I am not the authorized person. You have to involve my boss. So I have to create another person. Maybe Anupam. This guy is Priyanka's boss. I create this guy also in the system. One to many relationship, I can see now. Marlabs has Priyanka and Anupam Roy, both. Maybe both employees of Marlabs. Then my next process is what? Selling them products, right? That's the whole idea. So I will go to my opportunity. I can go to opportunity from here also. I can see this opportunity here. I can create a new opportunity here also. I can go and say Marlabs. July order. I have to select my account from here. Otherwise, it will not be associated. Or opportunity close date is mandatory, close and stage. So now, if I go to opportunities, one was created through lead conversion, June 1. July order got created, individual, directly on the table here. I can create a new opportunity from account also, from the related list. August, RLAP. August order. You see, when I create it from account screen, the account name is auto-populated. You don't need to do the connections. That is the benefit of doing it from here. But if you do that directly on the tab, then you have to choose the account. Got it? That is the only difference. Same with contact also. So now in my opportunity, I have three different orders. Let's go to my June order. Here I have to add products, right? Which products am I selling? And this will go through the whole sales process. There can be negotiations, proposal, quotes, everything, right? Decision making. You can change these stages also. We'll discuss all this later. So I'll mark this as now a product has moved in this stage. Now I have to choose which products to add. There can be different price book. By default, Salesforce gives a standard price book. If you are not choosing the price book, then standard price book is automatically used. But you can add a new price book also. Here I am choosing some products. You see, it already has the list price. Where from this is coming? Price book or price book entry?
Price book.
From price book, I'm getting the products. From price book entry, I'm getting the list price, right? Now it is creating a product. This table is opportunity product. You see, it has pulled the price from price book entry, auto-filled it. I have to give the quantity here. You remember the child object of product and opportunity is opportunity product. This is exactly that. I save it. So now this products related list is basically opportunity product related list. This is the child object, opportunity product, wherein I am seeing the products. All the products that is associated to this opportunities, right? And then I mark it to close. I have to choose either I have won it or lost it. If I won it, my sales process is over. My customer is closed. My deal is closed. My order has shipped. Clear the sales process?
Yes, sir.
Great. Fantastic. So we'll stop for the day. And I will let you play around and ask questions on WhatsApp, whatever you have in mind.
Okay, sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Or do you have appetite for more?
We have.
You no have?
Yes.
Okay. I think we have this timing set for 3:30. Shobhan, what is the timing? Can we go ahead?
Yeah, you can go ahead anyways.
Okay. So what one thing I wanted to show more, if we have time, before we close down, is... These are all standard objects and the sales process which we saw, right? What about I want to create my own object? So this is the custom object. What is the standard? Maybe registrations. Is some a new object which I want to create. It's a new table I'm creating. Yeah. One thing to note here, custom object is a new table you have created, but that does not mean Salesforce will not help you out in creating that. What is Salesforce giving you out of box from your custom object? That is a new table. Here, if you see now and search with registration, or you go down there, how to identify a custom object. First, the API name will have a underscore underscore C.
Okay.
all custom objects or custom fields will have a underscore underscore C, and it will call the custom object. If you go to this, go to fields and relationship. One thing to notice here, I have not created any fields till now, right? On this object, I've just created the object. But by default, Salesforce has already given some standard fields on my custom object. Is it clear? That means yes. Standard object can have standard fields and custom fields. A custom object can also have standard fields and custom fields. Of course, standard object will have many, many standard fields, but all custom objects will only have these four standard fields, not more than that. Created by, class modified by, owner, and the name field.
Animesh, what is the owner here? Is it the same like which user created it? Then what's the difference between owner and creator?
This is what you're asking basically is for the eighth session.
Okay.
Owner is the most important field of Salesforce. Entire security is revolving around owner. So we'll discuss this in great, great detail. There is a whole chapter, whole session only to talk about owner. Yeah. Too early for us to decide that or work on it right now.
Okay.
You'll not get it, get the concepts right now.
So, sir, will we discuss the functions we used in the scale like is blank and not or those?
Fourth session.
Okay.
Right now, it's all your practice match.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
No, here actually, I... as we practice on the prelet, so I came across to those. So that's why that.
Good. More you practice, when I will actually discuss the reason of using those, it will be crystal clear for you.
Yeah.
So I want you to keep on practicing right now. Mechanical, it will be completely mechanical. You will not understand a single thing, what you are doing, why you are doing.
Yes, sir.
Connecting.
We're just like following steps, like no reason at all. For some steps, I don't know why am I doing this. Like.
That is why this session is what we are doing, right? Here,
yes,
we will connect the dots. But if you have not heard about those concepts, not really clear what those things are, then that will be a wasted session. Then you have to go through this session twice. I don't want to do that.
Yes, sir.
I want you to connect the dots and ask me live questions on this session itself. That is why I want you to go through the sessions first. Sorry, the trailheads first. And when you are ready, you know, you have a lot of questions buzzing in your mind. These sessions would be the ideal sessions at that point.
Yes, sir.
Right? I think I have given enough materials for today. But again, you can create custom fields on standard object and custom objects. Similarly, there are multiple fields here. Multiple, we will go in full details in the next class, what these fields are, why we should use it, when to use it. Particularly, we'll cover lookup and master detail in full detail, and formula rollup. These four fields will go in full details, and rest is quite self-explanatory. But we'll also discuss this, and we'll touch upon all these fields. Okay. Yeah,
yes.
But you keep practicing right now and do it mechanically. Don't worry about it. You will really get to understand why it is used in our sessions. So this page layout is also something which you'll find out. So you see, Salesforce automatically creates a screen for us. It's a new object, right?
Yeah.
So another thing Salesforce also creates is that if you go to tabs, how will you create a data in this object? A new registration object, right? If you go and ask for a tab registration. Nothing there, right? No results. How will you enter data? No way, right? So I have to create a tab in order to access that object, isn't it? So I will go to custom object tab, choose my registration object, choose a tab style, and do a next. Then it will ask me which all the apps do you want this tab to be added? And this will be default on for which profiles? Maybe I will say default on for all profiles. There is no problem. Next. Add this tab to which object? We are only using on the sales subject, right? So let's add it only on the sales and sales lightning. Save it. when we do that and we go and do a search, refresh, you might be seeing that I am working on a separate tab in setup mode and in a separate tab on the normal business mode, because changes you are doing on the setup mode will reflect in the business users. The registration tab is now available. When you click that, you can create records. Now all these fields layouts are already created for you. And it has only one field, right, to enter. The rest of the fields, standard fields, are audit fields. So you cannot put any information there. You go to registration. All the fields which we have, only name field is editable. Owner, last modified, created by, is all controlled by Salesforce. So you cannot change anything. That is why you are only allowed to put the name. And do a save. Just like any other table, same. If you do edit, same, created by and last modified automatically populates for you. Got it? And you can also go and delete that if you want. Record is gone. Guys, play around, understand Salesforce, how it works, the business users, like a business user. Play around all these default objects, yeah, which we discussed today in great detail. And then we'll go forward and get into nitty-gritties. Thank you.
Is this the permanent timing for our session?
If this works for everybody, we can set up this as a permanent timing.
So, sir, can it be on the morning?
Have problem in morning.
Morning already, I have some current sessions already happening in the morning. So in the second half would be ideal for me. After 2 o'clock, I am available anytime.
Can it be on 6 p.m., 6 p.m. or 5 p.m.?
6 p.m. is fine for everyone.
If everyone agree to.
Let me know if 6 p.m. is fine for everyone.
So today's class is recorded, right?
Yes, it is recorded and I will be uploading it. And I will share the link.